to introduce to you this minister and pastor, Tim Haller.
Good morning. This is this will be a new level of challenge for me. So I'm gonna work my way through the emotions. I really can't say enough to Pastor Chris and Marge and all the other elders and ministers that stood up there. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the prophetic. Thank you for the prayers. I really truly I'm overwhelmed. That's all I can say. I feel like I'm having an out of body. I feel like I'm in my body, I know that, but I'm just gonna have to start going, and that's all I can do. I wanna start by acknowledging my mom and my dad. My parents were and continue to be excellent parents. The number one thing that I'll say my parents did throughout my entire life, from childhood all the way through my early 30s now, they have always, always, always consistently shown, demonstrated, communicated, and expressed love completely. I have never had a moment in my life where I've questioned whether or not they're for me. I've never had a moment in my life when I've questioned whether they're supporting me. There's never been a moment where I've buckled and said, does dad really love me? Does mom? It's never happened. I've never had that moment. And it's because of the way they've parented. It's my mom, she is a mother of three boys and one man child, the spouse of a man child, I should say. And, She had a tough go. You figure she was in charge of meals and groceries and keeping the house running, and she did all of our laundry for how many years? I don't even know. I don't know what you were thinking, Mom. And she took a part-time job while she was juggling all that. My mom is just an incredible woman that every day I'd come home from school, how was your day? What did you talk about? What happened? Like, and it's like, it wasn't the superficial, like, well, I'll just ask you because my mom cared. She wanted to know how my day was. She wanted to know what happened. She wanted to know what was going on in my life. And that's still who she is. My dad, every single little league team, every single basketball league, every single Wednesday, which was comic book day, we were at the, he was there every time, coaching the teams, taking me to the comic book store. When I was a little kid, one of my earlier memories that I have with my dad, we got the Nintendo Entertainment System, you know, the gray box. They just came out with a miniature version of it, where you'd play Super Mario Brothers. And my dad would play with us, and we were all little kids. And I remember thinking my dad was the most amazing Mario player. He was always there. And I've noticed something in my life now that I'm an adult in Christ. I don't ever question God's love for me. I don't ever wonder if he's for me or against me. There's never, well, is he 50% in and 50%? I know that God's behind me. I know he supports me. I know he loves me. And now but what's interesting is, I knew that going into Christianity because of them, because of my mom, because of my dad. I didn't have to be taught. And now I know the scriptures, I know the word, and I know that it says he'll never leave us or forsake us. I know that it says that there's no shadow of turning, that he's the every good and perfect gift is from above. There's, you know, he's the father of heavenly lights in whom there's no possibility of turning. I know that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. It's interesting learning the word of God after the fact, after I experienced it through the love of my parents. And, I think the last year I did Little League, I think I was 11 years old, approximately. I want to say I was younger, but that's probably not true. I think I was 11. And, you know, I wasn't an all-star player. I was average. I was fine. And every game, the team would have water and Gatorade. And so one particular game, we were at a field that there was no bathroom. And usually that's abnormal. There was almost always a bathroom available. And so this particular game, this particular field, there was no woods, there was no restroom, there was no gas station. And this was it. You're on your own, kiddo. And I just, you know, I didn't really plan accordingly. And so this is going somewhere, by the way. I drank my fill of my Gatorade and my water, and by whatever, I don't remember if it was a 6-inning game or not, I don't remember what the details, but you know, halfway through the game, I was filled to the brim. My bladder was ready to burst. And I was playing outfield, and I remember going through like this like cyclical thought in my head, like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? There's no bathroom, but I can't just leave the game, and if I leave, everyone's gonna know that. Like, I just didn't know. I was having an 11-year-old boy moment that there was like no solution for. And so I came up with my own solution. My solution was, well, if I could just take the edge off of this unbearable discomfort, then I'll be able to manage through the rest of the game and make it to a real restroom. And I learned a valuable lesson that day about biology. I promise this is going somewhere. When you're that full, there's no stopping once you start. That's the end of it. And so I thought, okay, I'll purposely just go a little bit in my pants, but not enough to be noticeable, and that will take the edge off and I'll make it through. And once I started going, it was over. I'm now an 11-year-old boy playing Little League with a team of my peers, my friends, and I have wet my pants. And the only thing that's saving me at the initial moment is I was playing outfield, and I'm like, okay, well, the glove's going to be here, and I'm just going to be, you know, like, hanging out low and hoping that nobody looks over. And so as soon as the inning ended, I ran over to my dad. I'm like, Dad, I wet my pants. And, like, you know, you can't get away with that at that age. That's the end of it. You're done. Your pee-pee pants for the rest of elementary school, probably into high school. You're now Mr. Pee-pee Pants. And so my dad obviously was surprised at my failure. But I noticed something about his response. After he realized and processed what happened, he was like, all right, quick, here. He took some Gatorade, he spilt it on me, so it covered me wetting my pants. And now everybody saw me have Gatorade spilt on me, but nobody knew that really I'd wet my pants. And so my dad, he hit a home run that day for me because he covered my failing. He covered my weakness. He covered my, like, that shouldn't happen to an 11-year-old boy without some sort of medical issue or other thing. Like, that was just pure ignorance and stupidity. That's what that was. And my dad saved me that day from years of ridicule, years of problems, years of nicknames. And I learned something about God that day, retroactively looking back now. God is the same way towards us. There are times where we wet our pants, and it's inappropriate and it's improper. How did that happen? You're better than that. You're beyond that. You're more mature. You're more able than that. And God doesn't say, well, son, bummer. Face it. No. You run to the arms of the Father, and he scoops you up and manages to concoct some scheme to protect you from your own failure. But if I didn't run to God, or to Dad, If I didn't run to my dad, that would have been it. I would have faced certain doom for an 11-year-old boy. But somehow intuitively and inherently, I knew my dad would have the answer. And so I played the rest of the game with Gatorade and urine in my, and that was, it wasn't my proudest moment, but it. Why am I telling you this story? Of all the possible stories I could have selected to illustrate a point, why would I choose that one? I want you to remember it. I want you to remember the point that God is a good God. God is a faithful God. God is an able God. God is for you and not against you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He'll never give up on you. He'll never chastise you and you know, turn you down. He'll if you're there turning to him, he's going to receive you. He's going to receive you. I'm hoping my embarrassing, somewhat self-deprecating, I'm hoping that story sticks with you, though. It will, he says. Yeah. Yeah. So the Bible has a word for that type of commitment. And so I was talking about my mom and her tirelessly laboring for the household and making everyone have everything they need and being that caretaker. And my dad just faithfully always being involved and dedicated and devoted and committed into everything we were doing. It didn't matter if it was sports or comic books or anywhere in between, my dad was there. And that word in the Bible, it's agape. It's a Greek word, and it's translated in our New Testament as love. And that word for love, what it really means, it's an unconditional devotion and commitment. And yeah, it's probably accompanied with feelings and emotions and all of the good things that come with that. But it's the commitment that the word is really about. My parents showed me agape. And I found that later on in life, when I came to know God through Jesus, I had such an advantage in understanding the way God looks at me as my Father in heaven. You know, it got to a point, at some point in my adolescence and early adulthood, I started to piece it together where I realized, well, if I'm going to interact with my parents, my expectation, just based off of the reality of my experiences, my expectation is that good things are going to come out of those interactions. And sometimes it was provision. Sometimes it was like, wow, thanks. You guys just helped me have a car that I would never be able to get on my own at this age. Oh, wow, thanks. You're helping me with school. I'd never be able to just do this without a student, so, without a loan. And so sometimes it was provision, but sometimes it was as simple as, let me just call my parents up just to see how things are going. And I know in that conversation, I'll be uplifted. I know in that conversation, I'll be refreshed. I'll feel the safety of their support and their commitment and their devotion. And now, as a 33-year-old man, when it's time to go down to Monroe, where they live, for a visit, I look forward to it because I know it's going to be a weekend or a visit or whatever it may be, a time, it's going to be a refreshing time. It's going to be a time where good things are going to happen. My mom's probably going to cook some awesome meal. My dad's probably going to order sushi or pizza or something delicious. We're probably going to just relax and hang out. And I now have an expectation that good things are going to come whenever I interact with my parents. The word in the Bible for that is hope. And so in the New Testament, whenever you see the word hope, it's actually talking about an exceeding expectation, an anticipation of the good things that God will bring forth. And in Romans chapter 4, they use that word twice in one verse. And it talks about Abraham, and Abraham being the father of faith and how we need to walk in his footsteps of faith. It compares our walk in faith to his walk in faith. And specifically, it compares our walk in faith to the point in Abraham's life where he was given a promise by God that he shall become the father of many nations. And what was interesting is that promise, you know, it was faced with contradiction and conflict because this guy is somebody who's already old and had never conceived with his wife. His wife was barren. And he may have been as well. There was no way to know that at that time. And so he has this word from God that states the impossible. And then by the time it's you know, a little bit has gone by, he's now 100 years old. His wife's womb that was already barren is infertile. And it says, against all hope, against every expectation, in hope, Abraham believed. And so I've come to find that it doesn't even matter what the situation is. It doesn't matter how many contradictions or conflicts there are. If I'm going to call my parents up, good things are coming. If I'm going to talk to God and interact with him relationally, good things are going to happen. They're going to happen. And so once again, because of the way my parents raised me, I now know what hope is. And I knew what hope was going in. And then I later learned what the Bible said. There's one other thing I want to mention about the way they parented. When you have a relationship where the message has been clear over and over again, time and time again, and that message is love and devotion and commitment and an expectation of good things, somehow it becomes very easy to trust that voice in your life from those people that bring that relationship to you. And I remember when I was a small child, and I don't remember what age exactly, but I remember learning how to ride a bike. And I remember the first time they took off the training wheels, and I remember what they'd do is they would guide me, kind of holding the bike, and then they'd let go, and then I'd pedal on my own and go, you know, that's how every kid learns, I guess. But I have these memories of those moments, and I remember their voice. I remember my dad's voice saying, "All right, son, it's all right. You know, you're not going to fall, and even if you do, I'll be right there." And I remember a couple times, maybe I had a minor slip up or trip up, but ultimately his voice was true in my life, and it guided me, and I could trust that voice, and because I had that voice in my life, I learned how to ride a bike a lot quicker than I would have if I was just some kid messing around with a bike without a dad. And so the word for that, where there's a voice in your life coming out of the relationship that you have with that person that instructs you and guides you and supports you, the word for that is faith. And so it talks about in Romans chapter 10 how faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of Christ. And it also talks about in Romans chapter 10 how if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You will be saved. And that statement in the book of Romans there, that's Romans chapter 10, verse 9. That statement, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's the explanation in the book of Romans for faith. It says, look, there's the righteousness that comes by faith. There's the word, the message of faith that's coming out of your mouth and coming into your, that word of faith, that message of faith, the explanation is you've got to believe in your heart and then confess with your mouth. And that produces an outcome called salvation. My dad taught me that in his own way with bike riding. You know, it's the whole thing is relationship. You know, it says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And let's go there. I actually left my Bible in the chair, but I've got the electronic version if it wakes up. All right, well, I'm going to quote it. I think, because I can't get, there we go. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. The whole thing, faith, is a relational activity. And the reason why it's impossible to please God without faith is because God's whole goal, his whole end game, is to have a relationship with you as an individual and as a body. And if you entertain that relationship and listen to his voice and allow his word to come into your heart, and then in hope believe that word that's entered into your heart and take action, that's called faith. The moment you take action based off of the word of God that's come forth into your heart, you take action based off of that trust, based off of that belief, that's called faith. And the reason why it's impossible to believe or to please God without it is because the entire system of faith is based off of being in relationship with him, and that's what God's all about. It's by faith that we're saved in Christ Jesus. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Pastor Chris, he quoted that one other verse that actually also happens to be out of Romans chapter 4, right in the same passage I was mentioning with Abraham. And he said, look, God is the God who calls things that are not as though they are. And so here's this supernatural being called God that is in the spirit realm. He's calling things that currently don't exist into being as though they already did exist. That's who God is. And because he's like that, and he's our Father, he wants us to tap into that same vein, that same mechanism, that same pattern, where we call things into being that currently aren't there. That's faith. And it's not according to our will and our whim. Okay, well, I call a winning lottery ticket into... No, it's not. It's about hearing the voice of the Father and letting that voice come into your heart. And then the response of you taking action, you taking confession upon that statement, that's faith. It also says in Romans, and I'm going to wind down pretty quick because we have less time today. It also says in Romans chapter 14, right at the end, it says, everything that does not come from faith is sin. And you read it and you're like, oh, no, that is not good. Because you're reading along and it's talking about like meat versus vegetables. And you're like, oh, I got this. I just had steak last night. No problem. And then like you get to the end of the chapter and it's like, and anything that is not from faith is sin. And you're like, dun, dun, dun. Like, it makes more sense, though, if you take a step back and realize, well, what is he asking for? What's the word really directing us towards? Relationship. If faith is my relational interaction with God, where he's speaking to me, I'm trusting what he's saying, and I'm taking action upon it, which, by the way, that's called obedience or submit. These are all these words are it's all connected. If God's whole endgame is to be in fellowship, relationship with me, with us, well, yeah, it makes sense that anything that I'm doing that's not born out of that relationship, that fellowship, it's sin. And if you understand the word sin, it's an archer's term. And basically the term means you have a bow and arrow and you shoot the arrow at a target. And if you happen to not hit the bullseye, doesn't matter how close or how far away, or even if you miss the target altogether, if you happen to not hit the bullseye, the center part of that target, that's called sin in archery. And so the bullseye of God's will is us being in a faithful relationship with him, whereby we're hearing his voice regularly with daily bread. Man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. And so there's a daily bread, there's a daily intake, the daily diet where God's speaking to every person all the time, every man, woman, and child on the planet all the time. God is after them, speaking to them. Doesn't matter how much they know, how much they don't know, how much they believe, how much they don't believe. I remember being in college, and it was like God had like some sort of like targeting computer on me or whatever, and it was just getting rammed with the gospel. It just was happening all the time, and I couldn't get away from it. And it's like, well, I could have chosen to ignore that. I could have chosen to block that out. I could have chosen to slam the door on that. But at some point, it's time to say, okay, God, you've got something for me. You're after me. You're for me, not against me. You love me unconditionally. You're light. There's no dark. At some point, it's time to open that door and receive the goodness of God into your life. And so, yeah, it's true. Everything that's not from faith, it's sin. Insofar as anything that you're not doing within the parameters of your relationship with God, that's outside of God's will. You can't rob a bank while you're relating to God properly. You can't do it. You can't binge drink to the point of intoxication while you're in the Spirit. Not going to happen. You can't end up addicted to drugs when you're in relationship with God consistently and properly throughout your day. It can't happen. And so, yeah, anything that's not from that relationship, it's a miss on God's will. And even though sometimes we all may have had those misses, Jesus paid for them with his blood on the cross. And so, in the interest of time, I'm going to come to a close in a minute here, but I want to take a moment. If there are people here today, and I don't care, and if I don't care, I think that's fair to say that the kingdom of God, they don't care about this either. It doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't matter what your level of knowledge or exposure to Christianity or church or the Bible or what, that doesn't matter to me. It doesn't matter to me what preconceived notions you came in the building with. It doesn't bother me if you've been to church your whole life or this is the first church experience you've ever had. It's all good. It all works. The point is, are you in relationship with God through Christ Jesus today, right now? Don't tell me about yesterday. Don't tell me about tomorrow. Are you there today, right now? And if you're not, God is knocking on your door. God is available right now. Kyle Burdick, he was in a store one day. I don't know, this was like a year or two ago probably. And it was, you know, him just buying some stuff, and he gets to the cashier, the cash register, and he notices that the cashier has like a bandage or something on their hand. And he wasn't looking in particular even for God's voice, but it just came. Because that's what happens when you're in relationship with him. Sometimes the word of the Lord just comes, unprompted. And the voice of the Lord came into his life and said, Kyle, you need to pray for that person. You need to lay hands on them right now. And so he did it. And it wasn't in his comfort zone, and it wasn't in his normal mode of operation, and it wasn't in something that he would typically do. But he did it. And then he scurried away. I wasn't there, so I'm basing this off of his own testimony here. He literally bolted out, didn't even talk to the person. He finished the prayer and left. I'm picturing it like a superhero moment, like Batman like swoops in and like saves some woman from being mugged, and she's like, wait, I didn't even get your name. And he's like, I'm Batman. And he like, and so he just left. And then, he comes back later, I don't know if it was later in the week or next month or what, later, some period of time, that same person was there. And she's like, hey, I know you. You're Batman. but she recognized, like, you prayed for my hand and I got better. Instantly, completely, totally healed in that moment. That story could have gone a different way. It would have been a very simple matter for Kyle to just be like, nah, that's not God, or let me think. I've been in moments where I've hemmed and I hawed and I fiddled around with what God was saying, and then the moment passed. And because I didn't take action in the moment where the door was open, I missed the opportunity for the kingdom of God to come forth. I missed it. And so did everyone else in the room at that moment. Don't let that happen right now. Don't fiddle around. Don't hem and haw. Don't say, well, there'll be another church service in a week. No. The moment is now. The door is open now. Be Batman, like Kyle. If God is speaking to you, and you know he's talking to you, you know, wow, I don't have that relationship. That's not where I am right now. Remember, it's not about yesterday. If you know you're not there right now, today, let's bow our heads. We'll close our eyes. We're going to do it the easy way. You're welcome. All I'm going to ask, if that's you and you want to receive that relationship into your life, that faith-based relationship with God through Christ Jesus, if you don't have that today, right now, I just invite you, while heads are bowed and eyes are closed, to slip up your hand high enough so I can see it. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Are there any others? Yep, I see those hands too. All right. So we're going to do this the easy way. I'm going to lead us in a prayer. And it's not my words that matter. It's your heart towards God that matters. And my words are just going to be the guide, the help to get you there. And so we'll just have everyone who raised their hands, plus the rest of the church for simplicity's sake, we're all just going to say this prayer together. And what I ask that you do, if you've raised your hand this morning, ask in this prayer, expect God to do something in your life. Expect God to come in. Expect there to be a change. Expect there to be a difference. Expect there to be an outcome from this prayer. And so let's all pray together. Father God, we come to you right now. We're not concerned about yesterday or tomorrow. It's today. We want to be in relationship with you right now. We confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord. We believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead. And now we invite Christ Jesus into our lives. Come and change us. Amen. And now, if you prayed that prayer and you meant it, your job is to connect with other believers and let them help you connect with God. Your job is to be a part of a church. I know of a good one. Your job is to open the Bible. Take 5 minutes, 20 minutes, 15 minutes, pray in the morning, and let God and His Spirit do a work in your life. Amen.